Now we come to tissues. What happened in tissues? In tissues, oxygen is low. This oxygen is coming with 100. This is low. Carbon dioxide is high, 45, right? So what's going on? 5 millimeters mercury difference here with, in carbon dioxide between what arrives and what is there. Not much, not stiff, but still enough to push it out. For oxygen, however, it's pretty high, 60 millimeters mercury, right? Oxygen is gonna diffuse. On the other hand, carbon dioxide also has higher solubility. Remember, higher solubility in the capillary environment, water is much heavier present than interstitial spaces, which also would account along with this 5 millimeters mercury difference, would account for diffusion of this carbon dioxide from interstitial spaces into venous end of the capillary. Now it's going through venous circulation. What we have here, 40 millimeters mercury of oxygen and 45 carbon dioxide, right, going into the pulmonary artery, so pulmonary artery back to the lung. In the lung, solubility of the air here high, so from more watery substance inside alveoli as opposed to thickness of the blood plasma, therefore in stiff concentration gradient between air pressure of the carbon dioxide and what arrives here. All both factors contribute, and there are other factors as well, unloading from the erythrocytes. Both those factors will contribute to exhalation of carbon dioxide. In inhalation of oxygen, because it's arrived at 40, and he is 160, right? So it's going in and becoming 104. This is how the gas exchange happened at every level, from ventilation, transportation, and internal ventilation, the internal respiration at the tissue level. Respiratory membrane, very thin, and again, composed of epithelial of alveoli and fused basement membrane and capillary endothelium. Has direct connection to erythrocytes, right, and can account for the gas exchange, oxygen diffusing in from the lung to the blood, into red blood cells and carbon dioxide, leaving red blood cells and going further. So this leaving and attaching to red blood cells, slightly different mechanism that we just discussed as to gases moving in from atmospheric air and out from the blood. This through respiratory membrane. And we'll talk about this as well. But for now, let's focus how it's all plays out in as far as interactions or coordination between alveoli and vasculature, which we call respiration-perfusion coupling. This is all called autoregulatory mechanism. So they regulate themselves as to how to best accommodate the gas exchanges and make it the most efficient. So the pressure of oxygen usually, and it's not possible to do without some kind of sensors or receptors that have to account in this case for pressure of gases, right? So it's some sort of baroreceptor that in arterial end, pressure of oxygen will change diameter of arterioles. Carbon dioxide, on the other hand, would account for bronchial diameter. And you think about this, if say oxygenic pressure here is reduced and pressure of the carbon dioxide in the alveolar is increased, right? It makes sense to reduce alveolar ventilation by reduced perfusion because you don't want to low oxygen and high carbon dioxide to go anywhere, right? in this case, pulmonary artery would be constricted and reduce flow of blood through the alveoli with a high concentration of the carbon dioxide. If we have enhanced concentration of oxygen going through and reduced concentration of carbon dioxide in alveoli, this would be the other way around. The pulmonary branches would be dilated, allowing more alveolar ventilation and perfusion for adequate exchange of gases. And we come back to this. So how, for example, pressure of carbon dioxide influence on the diameter of bronchioles, what happened? If carbon dioxide is high, the bronchioles dilate to push it out, because we don't want a high. We need enough to maintain bicarbonate buffer. This is where we need carbon dioxide. If it's high, then it has to be excess has to be eliminated. If alveolar pressure of carbon dioxide low, then it's gonna be constricted, preventing extra carbon dioxide. And you know, when we hyperventilate and we remove a lot of carbon dioxide, we have to maintain, bring it back. We have to breathe in this brown bag without any influx of oxygen in order to replace deficiency in carbon dioxide, because it's again very important bicarbonate buffering system in the body. And this picture about oxygen and what we already discussed with changing diameter depending on the pressure of oxygen, changing diameter of the blood vessels that serves those alveoli where pressure those alveoli and form the respiratory membrane where pressure of oxygen changes. So oxygen on the arterial side, carbon dioxide on the bronchial side play a role in this coordination. This is how they basically both maintain adequate gas exchange. Transport of oxygen through hemoglobin, and you know that heme bind one molecule of oxygen that bind to, directly to iron included in perforin heme molecule, forming oxyhemoglobin, right? It would be oxyhemoglobin that makes our blood scarlet red. On the other hand, carbon dioxide never ever ever binds to heme, to iron. It binds to actual hemoglobin as a protein. So 280-250 million of hemoglobin molecules in each tiny little red blood cells. So what we have? Oxyhemoglobin that is bound to oxygen. It reduce hemoglobin, deoxyhemoglobin, HH, right, the hydrogen substitute, would be when oxygen is released. And carbaminohemoglobin when oxygen, when hemoglobin has attached the molecules of carbon dioxide. Now, which we also talk about during hematology lecture, how hemoglobin is saturated, right? So how it's filled up with oxygen. And remember I told you about those three-dimensional structure of this heavy molecule. They connected through this binding structure a protein called 2,3-diphosphoglycerate. This phosphoglycerate practically makes this molecule unavailable for any kind of binding, right? Like, so bringing them all four subunits, alpha and beta chains, all together, and only when tiny little oxygen molecule will squeeze in and bind to one of the irons, it releases this bridge made by 2,3-diphosphoglycerate, and more oxygen bind to it, more it's released, Now all four bind to one molecule, but remember 250 to 180 millions of those molecules together in tiny red blood cells. This reveal of the, or release rather, of this hemoglobin molecule would affect others, allowing more hemoglobin to bind and more molecules gonna be sort of freed and more hemoglobin oxygen can bind again and again, which called hemoglobin saturation. Yeah, and it's going or follows this logarithmic or exponential curve. This is hemoglobin saturation, how it starts low with 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 4. And of course, this is for show, showing one molecule of hemoglobin, how it expand binding to oxygen. We're talking about 250, 280 million molecules, right? Saturation of hemoglobin can change in altitude where the pressure of oxygen at the high altitude, where the pressure of oxygen is low than at sea level. Level it's slightly less, but still here we have 98% of hemoglobin saturated. Here we have 95% of hemoglobin saturated at the high altitude. So there is a difference, but not much. The reason for this, first of all, fetal hemoglobin that given us from birth and then replaced slowly with adult hemoglobin has much more affinity, high affinity to oxygen than adult hemoglobin. A saturation sort of preserving oxygen in case of heavy work when it needs to be released, right? So if 95% saturated, then 5% circulates or doing something or used by cells. And the same here at sea level. So in people who live at the high altitude, percentage of residual fetal hemoglobin usually remains high, and therefore saturation becomes occurs faster. And this is what one of the factors. And the other factors, there are also other compensatory mechanisms that account for a high saturation with a low pressure of the oxygen. And if you look here, you will see what going on. Like, say, woman here is laying on the grass and not doing much, and saturation of her hemoglobin and her muscle is 75%. So all hemoglobin is 75% of the hemoglobin has oxygen attached to it. Practically, oxygen is not used at this point. This guy is swimming, hard physical work, and his muscles, the same biceps they show you, 40% saturated hemoglobin, meaning because his muscles do use it to bring, to create adenosine triphosphate. This is why. So this is huge difference between muscles at rest, where all hemoglobin has oxygen attached, and working muscles, where hemoglobin actively used in release from oxygen and goes to tissue. The other thing that can affect, so this is saturation and remaining of oxygen saturated or hemoglobin saturated, meaning oxygen attached to the heme, when there is no activity versus disattached, where it's a lot of activity. It's one side of the oxygen attachment to the red blood cells. The other is influence of pH on the attachment of both gases, oxygen and carbon dioxide, to the hemoglobin molecule. So if you have increased concentration of carbon dioxide, it means that there is increased acidity, right? Because carbon dioxide would react with water, forming carbonic acid, which is weak acid, and will fall immediately apart to hydrogen ion and bicarbonate ions. Then they're gonna go back and forth, but it still will create acidity if the concentration of carbon dioxide is high enough. Because if it's not, it simply would be used for the need of cells and tissue. If it's high enough, it's going to create acidity. This acidity or hydrogen concentration will weaken bonding between hemoglobin and oxygen. It's going to be replaced. This is why deoxyhemoglobin has this hydrogen attached to it. So in this case, since this will weaken the bonds between hemoglobin and oxygen, the carbon dioxide will make its way to red blood cells and enzyme form carbonic anhydrase, which will catalyze reaction of carbon dioxide with water, forming carbonic acid. That again breakdown to bicarbonate. This happened inside the red blood cells. And of course, it's with low pH, but what happened? So this is oxygen released in different levels of pH, right? Or saturation rather. So 7.5, relatively alkaline, right? Saturation remains high. 7.4 normal pH of our plasma, saturation somewhere in the middle, and 7.2 low. So no big difference between pH, but look at the difference between level of hemoglobin saturation. It's pretty significant. So we're losing, we're not using it for work, we're losing oxygen because it's not attached to hemoglobin due to acidity. Temperature also increases hemoglobin release. So if temperature is high, it's the other thing. Remember we talk about fever and febrile reaction, how it's bad, good, or indifferent for immune system. Well, one of the negative factors that high temperature would support to release of more oxygen, meaning that there would be under delivery of oxygen to the tissue that needed because they cells actively fighting pathogenic structure and trying to rebuild the tissue. So the one factor yet added to the list of factors that don't make high level of temperature or fever good for the body. So the low temperature would be the opposite, the tight connection between him and oxygen, meaning the saturation would be higher and release would be much more difficult. So this is the temperature, and that look of 10 degrees Celsius, 20 degrees Celsius, normal temperature outside 10 degrees. It's okay, it's spring, 20 degrees somewhere May, June. Temperature and those would be heavily saturated. When temperature goes up to 38-43 degrees Celsius, we have the low saturation. Well, this is probably I misled because this is blood. I have to reverse this, what I said, because I was perceiving it as an outside temperature. No, this is temperature of blood. Blood temperature, true, it's higher than body temperature. It's about 38 degrees Celsius. So this is where normal saturation of hemoglobin occurs, and those temperature would be low, so it's a hypothermia. Saturation of hemoglobin would be high and more difficult to separate oxygen from hemoglobin in this condition, meaning when it's hypothermia, when somebody freezing, the tissue do not receive enough oxygen and there is not enough energy for cells to deal with the problem. Where temperature is high, it's very easily separates, but again, it's not delivered, it can be separated and go somewhere else, not necessarily go to the tissue, it can get lost in the transition. So we have different type of hypoxia as a clinical manifestation of inadequate oxygen delivery to the tissue. Usually a clinical manifestation is respiratory rate, right? Cyanosis, meaning because there is no oxygen attached to, a low oxygen that attached to hemoglobin, the blood color would be like rather on the purplish bluish, and this is what we're gonna see. The color of the skin would be bluish or slightly purple. Hypoxia could be caused by anemia, right? Simply not enough red blood cells to deliver oxygen and to bind to hemoglobin. Then what we already talked, and we talk about this. Then another thing is chemical hypoxia, when we simply don't have enough blood vessels circulating, perfusing through the tissue to deliver oxygen. Histotoxic hypoxia, when the metabolic poisons or simply poisons, toxins, block the cells and cells unable to use oxygen. This would be histotoxic. Hypoxemic hypoxia, when ventilation is affected, it's through respiratory problem. And carbon monoxide poisoning that I already told you 200 times has greater affinity to hemoglobin than oxygen, and therefore easily replaces oxygen binding to hemoglobin. This is what causes death, tissue and brain including, stop receiving oxygen. Fetal hemoglobin, like I told you, a little bit different, and you can see here it's the four, but it's slightly different structure, therefore it's not so complexly folded and easier for oxygen to get access to the fetal hemoglobin. Affinity of fetal hemoglobin is much higher. In addition, it doesn't interact with this binding protein glycerol, phosphoglycerol, binding phosphoglycerol that I showed you, and doesn't have this tight attachment of subunits to one another. It's another thing that makes this fetal hemoglobin more accessible for oxygen. This is difference in saturation of fetal hemoglobin, right, between adult, huge difference. So what's going on actually in red blood cells? So at the tissue level, this is red blood cells. This picture you need to know with your eyes closed and need to know percentage and how everything happened here. So carbon dioxide due to pretty significant, well, 5 millimeters mercury difference between carbon dioxide pressure in the tissue versus in the blood. 45 in the tissue, we said, 40 in the blood, and high solubility of carbon dioxide, and obviously watery environment in the blood is much more present than in the tissue. Both factors contribute to movement of carbon dioxide from the interstitial spaces in the blood into red blood cells. Not all of it going into red blood cells. 93% going in. 7 stays in the blood, dissolves in plasma, and floating around, forming bicarbonate buffer or used otherwise by plasma elements. Out of 93 that diffuses in, 23 bind to hemoglobin, forming carbaminohemoglobin, but not to the heme, to the globin protein. 70% with the help of carbonic anhydrase converted to carbonic acid. Carbonic acid, like we said, dissociates immediately back and forth into hydrogen and bicarbonate. Bicarbonate mainly if there is request, which mostly is, we need to maintain pH in the body. Through the exchange channel with chloride going out and becoming bicarbonate buffer. Chloride coming in through this exchange channels, and on the other hand, the hydrogen ion would be removed or bind to hemoglobin, forming H hemoglobin, which we talk about, deoxygenated hemoglobin. So this is what happened. Pick up oxygen in the lung, right? Again, this is this diagram that you need to know, you need to understand this. Oxygen, stiff pressure between what's going on here and what's coming here, right here, 104. Here is 40, 60% difference. Coming in, some of it getting close, therefore in the blood we're now having 100. Oxygen bind to the heme, to the iron, and transported to the tissues through the capillary, through systemic circulation. In the capillary was going 100 pressure, right, versus very low 40 millimeters mercury, 60% difference coming in. In addition, acidity here very high, right, because here concentration of carbon dioxide high. It's react with water, it's forming acidity. In this case, we said increased pH releases oxygen, right? So oxygen release, carbon dioxide for the same reason, slightly different concentration, 45 versus 40, plus high solubility going in, 7% loss, 93% redistributed between 70 forming carbonic acid and used for bicarbonate buffer through chloride shift. Bicarbonate is released in the tissue and used, or in the blood, sorry, and used, and partially 23% attached to globin molecules, to proteins, and delivered to the lung. Here also could happen, if the bicarbonate buffer is not used, it can go back and convert it back to the carbon dioxide. If bicarbonate buffer, and in this case, chloride will enter the cell and get used in somewhere, sodium chloride, for example, would be formed. It's how chloride period gets here, through the sodium chloride. And then 7% of carbon dioxide that were released, whatever left of it also is gonna go in the lung. Why? Again, because concentration differences, right, in the air, atmospheric air, it's 0.3%. Here we brought 45% of carbon dioxide, and factor of solubility, the environment of plasma is less watery than environment of alveolar spaces. Therefore, carbon dioxide will go right into alveoli and exhale air. But only amount of carbon dioxide that have not been used is bicarbonate buffer. This buffering system, we already said many times, we went through this, so I don't see the reason go over this again, but it's the main buffering system in the body, because carbonic acid, it's weak acid, it's very easily dissociate to hydrogen ion and bicarbonate. At the capillary level, so we have this diffusion of gases, right? This balance of gases has to be maintained by flow of blood for oxygen delivery, and on the other hand, which is cardiovascular system working, and depth and rate of respiration, right? If we have fast, shallow breathing versus deep, slow breathing, it will affect gases differently, gas content, as opposed to, say, deep, fast versus slow, shallow breathing, right? Or something like this. Think about how the depth and frequency of ventilation could affect concentration of gases now. And if you're doing it long enough, right, fast, deep breathing, what happened? You get lightheaded, clearly your homeostatic balance is ruined. So, this account for the exchange between capillary and alveoli. also undergoes Haldane-Bohr effect. They work both together, which basically reinforces that we already said, influence of pH and influence and freedom of hemoglobin from oxygen. So what it basically states, the Haldane-Bohr effect. Bohr effect states that more carbon dioxide enters the blood, more oxygen dissociates from hemoglobin. Rightfully so, because pH changes.